When a raindrop falls here, it either flows north into Canada or south into the U.S. This ridgeline is the border.
Well,
my girlfriend and I have come to find the source of the Connecticut River. We're told it rises in a small pond just inside the United States.
Oh, it's so quiet.
These are the headwaters of the Connecticut River. And they smell, too.
They sure do.
And that's a beaver. There's a beaver dam. Beaver house.
Where's that?
Lodge,
oh, I see.
Over there. I see.
I'm restless like water myself, eager to journey from here to the ocean. I'm going to take a sample from this tiny stream and carry it to the river's mouth. A symbolic gesture, an excuse to travel down the river through a beautiful New England autumn. The Connecticut River starts in a series of four lakes. This is where my journey begins. This canoe is made from the bark of a birch tree, the way Indians made them. Rini won't be coming with me. I'm traveling alone, except for the video camera I'm using to document my trip, and for a small film crew that will occasionally meet up with me along the way.
Goodbye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, Sam. There you go.
I don't expect to see Rini and Sam again until I reach the mouth of the river 5 weeks from now. I grew up dreaming over maps. The farther away the territory, the more enticing it looked. But now I'm older, and I've had the chance to travel, cross some borders. Now my focus has shifted closer to home. I was born in New England. I grew up here. I wondered if there was anything left of those flinty, cold-roast Yankees who settled the valley. If not, who has taken their place? I'm pretty sure there are no Indians left. Here near the headwaters, it's hard to believe the Connecticut River was once notorious for its pollution. I've heard it's cleaner now, but I wanted to see for myself. What better way than to travel down the river slowly, camping out, asking questions? It'll take a couple of days to paddle through the lakes at the top of the river. From there, it's 400 miles to the sea. The Connecticut is the longest river in New England. The upper section forms the border between the states of Vermont and New Hampshire. It then flows through western Massachusetts and Connecticut, emptying into Long Island Sound. On the map, it looked like an easy journey, all downstream. I thought it would be a lark.
They say that there are good trout in this lake. And this is what I catch them with. It's called a hornburg, and it's a good all-round fly for catching trout, maybe even a salmon. Oh, and I have it. Actually, it's easier to catch canoes and people. And that's what I've done here. Good.
I love to fish. 30 years ago, there were hardly any good fish left in the Connecticut. I've read that they are now trying to bring them back, trout and salmon, and spent millions of dollars in the effort. I hope I can catch one. After all, some of those millions are my tax dollars, too. Between the lakes, the streams aren't navigable, and I have to walk. These wheels are great. And I'm sure if Indians had had tarmac and wheels, they'd have done this too. I am walking to the town of Pittsburgh, New Hampshire. It used to be the Republic of Indian Stream, formed in 1824. They were proud and independent, very New England, wrote their own constitution, and held out for 30 years before being taken over by New Hampshire. here in the Indian Stream Cemetery, I'm looking for the grave of an Eskimo. It's a strange story. In 1898, a 6-year-old boy named Minik was brought from Greenland to New York by Robert Peary, the Arctic explorer. He was given to the Museum of Natural History along with his dad, Kwisuk, and 4 others as so many study specimens. They all got sick and soon died, except Minik. Years later, in the museum's basement, Minik discovered a skeleton in an exhibit case. It was his father. Minik's quest after that was to reclaim his father's bones. He never succeeded. Minik found peace in his own life here in this valley, where he worked in a lumber camp. He died of influenza at the age of 28.
Oh, here it is. Here it is. Oh, Miniwa. And someone has laid flowers on it. I've always felt very close to that story because for some reason I'm trying to be a bridge between a way of life that doesn't seem to exist anymore. It's like Indian ways or Inuit ways in the face of Western progress. I don't know why, but I think that's got a large part to do with why I travel.
Don't like it.
The upper valley is wild, rougher all around than I expected, even in the rapids. I didn't want to damage the birch bark canoe. It's not fragile, but it is precious, like paddling a piece of history.
Oh, Jesus!
My canoe was made by a friend named Henry Valancourt. He has spent 25 years perfecting the art of making birch bark canoes. He lived with a family of Cree Indians who taught him about birch bark and a way of life. Henry carries forward their tradition, keeping alive a beautiful part of the past. He builds 4 canoes a year. Most end up in museums, but I wanted to paddle mine the length of the Connecticut. I've traveled in plastic and I've traveled in metal, and there's just something graceful and silent and beautiful about a birch bark canoe. It's beautiful. My biggest problem is keeping my eyes away from the canoe and watching for the rocks in the river. It just sounds like water. When I'm paddling this, it doesn't make a noise. It's as though I'm paddling water itself. It's so fitted to the medium it travels in. I had to get out and portage around a small dam. And on the road, I met a man who took a keen interest in my canoe. He collects them, and he too has a birch bark.
Well, I hope I can see this.
If you like, sure, we can go. There's some daylight. We can go up to the barn, and I've got a couple up in the barn.
Must be cold working in here in the winter.
Yes. I have a very small apartment.
Jerry's from New Jersey and teaches in the local high school. He is trying to keep alive an interest in Indian ways. Not satisfied just to read the history, he spends his summers on Indian reservations asking questions. He's gone to great pains to build his birch bark canoe as the Indians did.
Yeah. Hmm. Well, so. Anyway, here's it a Gunkwin style. See the wood pegs?
Yeah,
okay,
you got
the
wood pegs.
The maple.
Yeah.
And no nails. See the difference of size of spruce roots?
Uh-huh.
You know, the history book has one paragraph of our forefathers' landing. One paragraph of the Mayflower. That's it. Then they talk about everything else. And do they elaborate on the Indians?
Not much.
Not much. Have we given justification to the Indians? No. they had a common sense, and sometimes us, we don't, some people lack common sense. The world runs on the average person. There are very few geniuses. They had that intelligence, that drive, that harmony, the blend, the work together, foresight in some things. They respected nature.
Do you have a video camera to record anything?
No.
Get one.
My friend, he's got one with a Sony, but you plug it into the TV and you can see it, and then this other one says, no, you want the one, the cassette, and then there's an adapter. Don't get the big VH. I don't know what to do. I'm ignorant, and I'm trying to learn, and I've got to. I've got to.
Look through there. Hold on to it. Hold on to it.
Hold on to it.
Yeah. Just look through there.
Okay.
See, I mean, you can. That's what you get. And when you're talking to an Indian or you're looking at the way they build their canoes, that's how you know, you'd have a record, and he's trying to tell you something and you can't remember what he says.
Right.
Then you can remember what he says.
Because you have it.
Because you have made a document of it.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess I'm going to have to put some money together and stop buying canoes.
Traditional Yankee ways are changing. New Hampshire and Vermont used to be the bedrock of Puritan values, but now sponsor a state lottery. The prize is at least $1 million and goes up each week if no one wins. I decided to try my luck.
21, 18, 36. I see, not just, you gotta be, I mean, when you put six numbers, you meant.
Six numbers from 1 to 40.
Right.
That's your ticket.
That's my ticket.
4, 18, 19, 21, 34, 36. If that number comes up, you're a millionaire.
How
it's going to cost you a dollar to play it.
Yeah, I know. But how much do I win?
$3 million. $3.1 million.
Adrian Block, a Dutch explorer, first recorded seeing the Connecticut River in 1614. I cannot imagine what the first Europeans felt seeing this land full of everything that had long been exhausted in Europe, virgin forests, abundant game, and rivers teeming with fish. The river has etched its signature in the stone and the deep-cut Connecticut Valley. The floodplain is rich farming soil. Water is the element I feel closest to. I don't know why. Maybe because the river remains one thing that knows nothing about time. Meanders and oxbows still exist, but who ever knows a river? You can't hold it like a stick. The Connecticut is not the blue line on the map. It is a whole system of living water. 148 tributaries flow into it, draining an area of 11,000 square miles. I have the river to myself. Hours of peaceful paddling through an enchanting autumn landscape. The river looks healthy here, almost untouched. Sometimes I do not know whether I'm paddling on the water or through the sky.
Great place. Thinking about the last week, it was about a week ago that I began, and it's been a wonderful week. It's a much wilder river than I thought it was. It's not built up on the shores.
I came to another town. There was talk of having seen a bear nearby.
Oops. Well,
it was hanging up right there.
All right.
She left me at a welding shop and suggested I ask inside. The welder was French-Canadian. I asked him if he'd seen a bear nearby. He said, yes. It was right outside behind the shop.
But is that open now?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it worked.
He's right here.
Whoa.
That's a good size one. It's 385 pounds.
385?
Yeah, 385 pounds, yeah.
Wow. And how did you shoot him? What's the story?
Well, he was going to the cornfield there, and that's where I shoot him. Yeah.
Did you know when he was there? Were you waiting for him?
Well, yes. Sometimes they go, sometimes not, so.
Yeah.
I got to watch him for, so.
Yeah. Do you go every year to do that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, but last year I never got none.
Uh-huh.
But this year there, then, I got some luck, so.
Did you do anything to say, you know, you were not sorry for the bear, but the spirit of the bear? Is, you just shot him and dragged him in?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. The farmer gave me a hand there and put that in the pickup, and that's it. So, it's a very nice one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, that's my sport, you know, there. I like to do that there. It's a good sport for me.
But I was a coward. I couldn't tell the man my opinion. I couldn't tell him how awful I thought it was, because I could just see he saw the bear, he shot the bear. It's what he does, and he said it was for sport. I think if you define sport, it is a competition between two willing and consenting adversaries. I don't think that bear walking through that cornfield consented to being part of the sport. It's murder.
I'm angry at the hunter because he did not respect the bear. He hung it as a trophy. But I'm mad at myself, too. I'm no judge. I also hunt and fish, but I eat what I catch and pay my respects to the animal spirit. Does that make it any better? It's my dilemma.
It's beautiful monarch butterfly that's on its migration down to Mexico. Can you believe it starts in Maine and it's going to Mexico? And I'm gonna try and help you out, boy. You can dry out on my canoe.
Identical machines, just different numbers on the side.
I could hear other calls of the wild, but this sounds to me like a different kind of wildlife. I thought these machines were used in the winter, but here they are in a field on the banks of the river racing snowmobiles on grass. Maybe they race lawnmowers in the winter.
82 miles an hour.
82. What's the range that they're usually coming up in?
Well, right here, it's 660 feet on grass. Not bad today for that kind of speed. You know, I think last year we had about 89.
It's not the speed that wins, it's the ET. You know, so I can run 75 miles an hour, he can run 90, but if I'm quicker off the line and get to the other end first, I win. So far, I've won every race so far, and I've moved up to the final.
Manning, piloting, 93, 81. So ready, the three is underway.
Time to check my lottery ticket. For 3 days, I've been dreaming how I'll spend my millions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, man, I need some.
No win.
No win?
Unfortunately.
Oh. Did anybody win?
No.
Nobody won.
No, it's up to 3.6 million.
Until now, the river has been mostly untouched by man. Now it's different. The Connecticut Valley was the birthplace of American industry, and the river supplied the power. As New England prospered, large hydroelectric dams were built. Behind the dams, lakes were created that cover hundreds of acres, what used to be dry land. It's not only the river the dams disfigure. The ghostly thing is paddling over the abandoned farms and towns, all those memories buried underwater. For most of us, the river is an obstacle to cross over on a bridge. We glimpse the Connecticut from the car window as a slice of water, not as a living thing. The faster we move, the less we can hear the river's song. On the river ahead are Hartford and Springfield. Within 100 miles are two huge cities, Boston and New York. They all need power, lots of it. The power from these dams is sold into a huge grid supplying New England. I have to check with the dams about water flow before getting in below them. If they let out a big surge of water, I could be swept away.
John.
Hello.
Hey.
Hi. I was coming through the dam today, and I wanted to find out about the times, if there are any, when you're letting water out.
Coming through the dam? Which dam?
Oh, which dam?
Yeah.
The one right here.
Oh, okay. I'm not sure.
Where are you?
I'm at Comerford. I didn't know where you were at.
Oh, I'm at Comerford, too.
Okay. Well, right now we are generating about 38 megawatts. We're actually right up to 10 o'clock. Between 30 to 40 megs, so.
The guy reassured me I wouldn't be swamped, even if all the lights and hair dryers in New England were switched on at once. This is the last big dam. I'm still 300 miles from the river's mouth, but it looks like smooth paddling. We'll see. I've been traveling 2 weeks on the Connecticut River on my way to the ocean. There's a hint of winter in the air. In just 2 months, the valley will be blanketed by snow. This section of river has been a handsome mix of meditative paddling and short rapids, picturesque villages, my way blocked only occasionally by huge dams. I've seen a lot of birds, but nothing to rival the upper valley for wildlife. That dead bear still haunts me.
Anything that's been written on previous cop rehabilitation has generally ended up in a very sad story.
Yeah.
Either being shot by bait hunters because the only food they could recognize is...
In Lyme, New Hampshire, I joined a friend I'd not seen for years, Ben Killam. He surprised me with a bear story of his own.
In fact, they just didn't know anything else.
Hi.
Ben is a wildlife rehabilitator, now surrogate mother to these two cubs. He was asked to raise them because they had been abandoned by their mother. Last year was a bad one for nuts and berries, and the mother was too thin to raise the cubs herself.
Is it regular milk?
Lamb's milk replacer.
Mm-hmm.
He's interested in your camera.
Really?
Hey, that's enough. Hey.
So in a year, when will you let them go?
Next spring. They accept you because I brought you. If you came here by yourself, you wouldn't be accepted.
You'd be a strange
smell.
Ben was learning a lot about black bear cub development.
I have a strong liking for bears. What are some of the other animals you've worked with?
Well, since being kids, yeah. Christ, everything from raccoons to fisher to... When I was 2 years old, there's a leopard running around the house.
The cubs are lucky they have each other to play with. It makes them less dependent on Ben. Within a year, they'll double in size and begin to establish their own territory alongside other wild bears. I mentioned the dead bear and my outrage. To my surprise, Ben defended the hunter.
Hunting is a tool of wildlife management. What the hunter does is a personal matter. It may be disgusting or it may be perfectly acceptable.
No, but when I asked about the respect, would he eat the meat or would he do anything with it? And he says no.
Well, some of them only hunt for trophies, but it doesn't matter. I personally prefer to eat something that I shoot, but that doesn't necessarily mean that everybody has to. If you put too many regulations on it, ultimately you'd have no hunters. And hunters are going to become a scarcer and scarcer item as the years go on, because all the social pressures of this country as it develops are going to be towards urban people and less and less understanding of what's necessary to maintain healthy wild populations. Mm-hmm. And as nice as these guys are, you still have to have some control of the matter.
Ben has a point, but I hope his cubs don't get shot. I've heard about the effort to bring salmon back to the Connecticut. One problem is that dams block the river. Now power companies are required to build fish ladders to help salmon get past the dams. I haven't caught a salmon, but maybe I'll see one here at Wilder.
Is this where the ladder is? I mean, the viewing window?
Yes, it is, but the fish ladder's closed.
Oh.
Do you have an appointment?
No.
Okay. Our visitor center is closed today.
Yeah, they told me that.
Yeah.
Tell me again, how many salmon have come up since
the... At Wilder Station, just five, since the ladder was opened in 1986.
Now, does that make you think that it was a program, is it a good program to try and bring them back? If they...
Economically, it's a disaster. I think that maybe this station was overkill. It seems as though the fish are primarily going up other tributaries of the Connecticut.
You mean all the effort you put in here to...
Right. Certainly questionable.
Well, I'm just north of the first major city that I'm coming to, which is Brattleboro. And I've got my bottles. I was going to try out the water here in the river. Looks pretty good.
What a beautiful morning it is. How quiet, how peaceful. They don't slow for birch bark, stinkpots. How can they appreciate nature roaring and whizzing past it? Gas and oil leak into the river, the wake erodes the bank. But at least they're out here enjoying the river, appreciating it. Overlooking the river stands a brand new shopping mall. I need supplies and roll my canoe up the hill. I had heard about this Walmart's, the first large discount store built in the North Country. When Vermont refused to have it, they built just across the river in New Hampshire. These stores are controversial because they undercut local merchants. They're so successful since people today would rather pay less than support the older character of their towns. Sam Walton, the man who founded this chain, started with nothing and died the richest man in America.
Thank you.
Hi, Hi. Can I get two dogs?
Security tape.
What size?
Medium.
Medium.
That guy. Yeah. Okay.
This store has everything, and it's for less. You can even get your child's picture taken in front of a cardboard forest.
Haley.
How many pictures do you get when you?
I think it's 81. Yeah, 81 pictures.
Oh, 81?
Yeah. Look, she's gonna shine the light on you.
Uh oh, look at my light.
Watch.
Uh-oh. Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
I don't know about Walmarts. I felt sure my canoe wouldn't fit in their forest. I'm more at home on the river. Before Europeans arrived, Indians farmed, fished, and hunted up and down the Connecticut Valley. Their stories wove the river and the land together. They placed minimum demands on the earth. They did not seek connections between things. They saw them. We've replaced their myths with our own, imposed control on nature, twisted it out of shape. The Indians believed the river sings for itself, that everything sings for its own pleasure. Only we require an audience. We ask a lot of the river. Further up, we dammed it for electricity. Here, we've built a nuclear power plant using river water to cool the reactor. There are two on the Connecticut, and they seem to me like unexploded bombs. One bad mistake, and the river would be poisoned, perhaps for hundreds of years. The Connecticut is a large river for New England, but small compared to western rivers like the Mississippi and the Columbia. Those larger rivers are small compared to the Amazon, but they all face the same demands we place on them. We can no longer imagine there is an endless supply of clean water. If you want to see if people are thinking ahead, look at their water. Not all the motorboats I see are in a hurry. After 3 weeks of paddling, I wasn't above accepting a tow. I've crossed the border into Massachusetts. At Turner's Falls, I found a modern laboratory devoted to the effort to return salmon, shad, and sturgeon to the river. The scientists here have learned that building fish ladders is not enough. They have to convince the fish to use them, not only the mature fish on their upstream passage, but also the young fish returning to the ocean.
They're pretty wild fish.
They've spent millions of tax dollars trying to find out what fish want. I told one scientist about the people I'd met who felt the project had failed.
Actually, those people should think about 25 years ago or 30 years ago where you couldn't even dare swim in the Connecticut River, let alone have fish coming up and downstream from the ocean to the Connecticut River. Right now, you can actually count hundreds of salmon coming back to the Connecticut River. You can count hundreds of thousands of shad coming up to the Connecticut River, blueback herring, sturgeon, all these species that would have otherwise been extinct in the Connecticut River, now they're back.
All that money spent to get back what we've lost. Nature's giving us the bill for our short-sightedness. Up until the 18th century, Indians gathered each fall, trapping salmon and sturgeon, taking what they needed. When Europeans settled here, they fished the river out. By 1800, the salmon runs were over. By 1900, the Indians were almost gone too. I spotted another canoe, a birch bark. At least it looked like birch bark. And paddling it were a couple of Indians. At least they looked like Indians. The canoe was aluminum, painted to look like bark, but the Indians seemed genuine. Their names were Black Snake Woman and Traveling Medicine Dog. I wondered where they came from. I was curious. Black Snake Woman explained that she had not always lived this way.
I used to be married to the Winston man from TV. I mean, you know.
Before my time.
Yeah.
But he was a man in a commercial?
Yeah, you know, commercial. I had a maid. I lived in a big fancy house when Otter was young. He was rich, and that was my lifestyle. So if you would ask me then, would I be living now? I'd say, no, probably not. But I never was happy. And so you can't live your life being unhappy unless you're a fool. So I made my moves.
Put it over here. Well, let's just see. Will this be big enough for us? It should be.
Now I'll sleep outside probably in my tent, or I don't know what
you... Don't you want to sleep in here?
Well, we're all going to stay together.
Oh, okay, yeah, you would.
I think.
Didn't want to...
Three of us in
the
fire?
Yeah.
Cozy-tozy.
Ooh.
I think.
Black Snake Woman is a member of the Blackfoot Nation. When she moved to the river, she started a school teaching Indian ways. Traveling Medicine Dog was a student who took her lessons to heart. He now lives with her as an adopted son.
Bear berry's traditional, but I don't use it. Sometimes I do, but not always. Ooh, she smells so good. I've got willow bark, inner willow bark in there. What else have I? Sage I got in there this time. Everybody has their own secret blends. You don't tell anybody else what's in there. That's why I'm not telling you.
Oh, good. No.
Is that how you did it?
Yeah.
Oh.
They have a house on the banks of the river, but they prefer the teepee.
Is there coal?
As I watched, my respect for them grew. They were skilled woods people, knowledgeable about Indian traditions, and had a great love of nature.
Stick that under our bark. Put that in there. You get here.
When she was married to the Winston man, she was known as Gail. I asked her how she came to be called Black Snake Woman.
We were going along, and I was feeling those footprints, and all of a sudden, I put my hand out. Well, what the heck is this? Something strange. Big and cold. And I got right down on the ground. Look, what the heck is that? And I got down, and here was the snake looking at me. I looked at that snake, and those kids were behind me with their mouths open. And then I did something I never thought I would do. I reached out, and I touched the head of that snake. And when I did that, it did something I never thought it would do. It arched up in my hand like a cat. So they talked about it all night long. Oh, that snake was really something. I couldn't believe when you reached out and touched that snake. That was really something. Then, not long after that, the kids gave me that name, Black Snake Woman. And I took it because every time I thought about touching that snake, I felt powerful and beautiful. And that's what my dad said was the native way of thinking, that you should always strive to be the most beautiful and the most powerful that you could be.
The next morning we said farewell. Traveling Medicine Dog fired his musket. When I met them, it was hard to take them seriously, dressed up in 18th century clothes, smoking peace pipes, and living in a teepee. But being with them, I saw they represent a voice of the river, one that reminds us there is a history, an Indian past. It may look foolish against all the high tech around us, but sometimes high tech looks foolish too. I've come through the wilder part of the river. Now I'm heading toward two big cities, Springfield and Hartford. Huge populations. It makes me nervous. Two-thirds of the Connecticut River is behind me, and I have at least 10 days of paddling to reach the ocean. I'm coming into the city of Springfield, Massachusetts. The next 100 miles are the most heavily developed part of the river. More bridges, more noise, more people. The river here has become dirty and sluggish, scuffed, and my mood is reflected by the weather, misty, cloudy, and damp.
I feel like I'm coming into some great big stomach that's not feeling very well. All this noise and churning motors. You just feel the speed at which people are traveling. So different from the upper valley.
For the Indians and first settlers, the river was the heart of their life. It fed them and was their highway. Later, when we had roads and factories, the river became a place to dump our waste. Not just industry, towns and villages too. Since the 60s, things have improved dramatically. When this film was made in 1959, the river was filthy and known as the most beautifully landscaped cesspool in America. The film was produced by the Connecticut River Watershed Council, an organization created by the power companies to dramatize the river's plight. Through this effort and the work of other private groups, a Clean Water Act was passed and the river has begun to cleanse itself. The river is healthier, but there's still a long way to go. In a particularly unattractive cove, I saw another canoe and went to visit.
I don't see that many canoes.
I can believe it.
So I'm just following you. Are we going up here?
No.
Are you going up there?
Real or is that plastic?
Is that a genuine birch bark?
Yes, it is.
Wow.
So how do you like canoeing among all the shopping carts?
Oh, we don't. We do this because we're in this river watch business.
Oh, yeah. I've heard about these guys.
Yeah, we sample the water, do it about once a month.
The main purpose of the whole thing is to get an idea of what the pollution and the problems are with the Middle River.
The organization they belong to, River Watch, monitors the water quality of the river and its tributaries. For the past 3 years, Mr. and Mrs. Beeks, both scientists, have volunteered to take water samples in their spare time. They've learned that to influence public policy, they need hard evidence.
Actually, it doesn't change too much. The big thing that changes is during a rainstorm, the E. coli just soars. Because of there's a tie-in between the sanitary sewer and the storm sewer, so when the sanitary sewer gets overloaded because of rain, it just pops right into all the rivers.
The E. coli he refers to is a microscopic bacteria found in human waste, not something you want in a river.
A little tug on that.
I was inspired to show them my water sampling device.
See, that's
that's the beginning, and that
that's
is
the beginning.
That's an oil and vinegar set, a Cruet set, I would guess.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Well, I saw it in a store, and I bought it, and I put the fourth lake water in this side, and what I've been doing is collecting.
Oh, in this one, and then comparing it.
Just comparing the color, because I can't really.
Yeah. Okay. What does the color here compare?
Well, let's see.
Is this empty right now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Dear, Connecticut doesn't have that good water, unfortunately.
So hold it over here too, so.
Well, of course.
Well, you know what? Right now it looks like this one is lighter than this one. That was in the lake?
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning of the river?
Yes, it was, yeah.
Okay.
I've always felt the individual is the basis for change, not bigger things like governments. It is private citizens and grassroots organizations that are saying to industry and towns, you can no longer pollute our river. Laws have been passed, companies fined. Now, outflows like this have to meet standards of cleanliness. A man I met on the bank remembered how it used to be.
Oh, sometimes you'd see the water coming down all different colors. One day it'd be pink, the next day it'd be blue, and it'd be purple. The dye they used, you know.
Huh. So they just never thought about it.
And they got fined more times. Yeah. Oh, and millions of dollars, too. Mm-hmm. And finally they put in their own plant.
My father says so many laws have been passed, so much money spent on saving the environment, you environmentalists will be the death of us. But he likes giving me a hard time. I'm not very political, but I vote every day through what I buy, how I spend my money, how I spend my time. People can use the river again for pleasure, for time off. Wouldn't it be great to strike the right balance between making the river work for us and us working for the river? A renaissance is occurring slowly. I hope it's not coming too late, but we now realize what effect we have on our world and that we are not the only game in town. Just downstream from a sewer treatment plant, I found out what the River Watch people were talking about.
It rained heavily last night, and what I found out is that the towns and the city along the river here have their sewer systems connected to the water drains, and when there's a heavy downpour, the two get mixed together and discharged directly into the river. Well, you can't see anything, but you do smell it. It's a pretty strong smell.
Near Windsor Locks, Connecticut, there's an old dam that the river has broken through. This is my chance to get back at all those dams I had to walk around. I'm coming into Hartford, Connecticut, largest city on the river, and home of America's insurance industry.
This is the home of Wallace Stevens, one of America's great poets. He had a wonderful sense of language. Oh, God, I can't remember a word of his poetry, but he worked for an insurance company in Hartford, and he'd make up his poems on his walk to work. Get into his office and he'd say to his secretary, Miss Niff, take a poem.
The city did not look welcoming, and I couldn't find a place to land. In the 40s, Hartford turned its back to the river, building massive flood barriers. Now they realize their loss and are spending millions to reopen the waterfront.
Where you started from?
The Canadian border.
Damn! How many days you been out here doing this shit?
1 month.
A month?
Yeah.
Damn! I admire somebody like you, man.
Well,
I've been in flipped. I'm serious. It's been like, damn, what's wrong with him? I think he's been out in the water too long.
Well, I think I have been out in the water too long.
Just outside Hartford, I met two city workers repairing a boat landing. Kevin wanted to see my canoe.
Birch bark. See?
Damn, you came a long way in a little boat like this,
man.
This ought to be history or something, ain't it?
No, well, other people have done it. Not the first one, but I'm just one of the other fools.
Well, do what you like. You know, that's, you only live one time, man. Like I said, I admire you for doing this, though, because there ain't no way you can get me out in the water with no nah. You can't even get me in an ocean liner. My dream is to hit the lotto. That's my dream, to hit the lotto.
And what would you do with it if you hit it? I've been trying all the way down now. I haven't hit it yet.
I'll tell you right now, I wouldn't quit work right so fast. I hang in there for a while.
Well, you're inspiring me to get another ticket. Maybe I'll do that.
I hope you luck, too.
Well, I wish you luck.
You'll be the man to hit, though.
No, no, no.
You'll be the man to hit. Then you can come down here and do the same thing in a bigger boat.
There was a great view of the river. If only I'd opened my eyes.
It's a dry.
I got the one horse here that doesn't go up and down. Giddy up, giddy up.
I seen Jordan do this. And I've never seen him do that. I got one.
What are you gonna do? You play so great.
No.
Haven't caught a fish.
Thanks.
Haven't won the lottery, but at least I've won something.
Yeah. I know. Sam is gonna love this.
Perhaps the greater prize has been the journey. I've seen many people, listen to a lot of stories. Before I set out, the river was something to cross on a bridge. I knew little about it. I've been surprised all the way along. Instead of an industrial river, scuffed and worn down by our demands, I've seen a miracle. The river has a long way to come, but the miracle is that we want to restore the river to health and are willing to make sacrifices for it. What a marvelous journey. I've been one drop of water carried along. Now I'm about to join the sea. I smell the sea, feel the tug of the tide. I feel a mixture of sadness and anticipation. Sad the journey is ending, but eager to see Renee and Sam. We'll paddle the last miles together.
Hi, Reedy.
Hi.
Hi, sweetie. Look, Sam. Look who's there. You're probably going to jump overboard.
Oh. Yeah, how about that? Okay.
Heaven's here, isn't it? Not a storybook heaven, but one we can see and taste, teeming with life, one that will care for us if we care for it. For the last 5 weeks, the river has been my home. We traveled together down to the ocean. I began my journey as a visitor, thinking just to pass through, but discovered how the river binds things together. The past to the present, the land to its creatures, and us to them all. These are home waters.